Hi YouTube, this is Joe Calton from Calton Cutlery. You can find us on the web at CaltonCutlery.com. Today I'm finally going to do the video on hand sanding. Hand sanding a blade. I've been meaning to do this video for quite a while and I just haven't got to it yet. But anyway, so today we're going to do it. Hand sanding a blade is the most dangerous thing so far that I have found in the shop. You know, the power hammer, the grinders, the bandsaw, you know, I mean, everything. The worst injury I have ever gotten in the shop was from hand sanding a knife. No kidding. You know, 2 horsepower motors on the grinders, you know, 2,000, 2,400 degree temperature in the forge and foundries. And the worst injury I've ever received was standing here with a piece of sandpaper in my hand, rubbing it up and down on a knife blade. Go figure, right? Okay, so we'll start with my setup. Okay, what I have here, I like to work standing up. Not really sure why, I just like to do it. So anyway, so you start when you're... The hand sanding setup needs to start from the bench. Now this bench right here is a butcher block style setup with 2x4s that have been glued and screwed together sideways. So there's like 32x4s from here to the wall. Okay, so it's a really sturdy setup. If I had to build the bench again, one of these days I probably will. I probably wouldn't build it like that because it took an awful lot of planing to be able to get the bench top mostly level. Anyways, so those 2x4s are bolted to 4x4s, and there's 6 of them supporting the bench top. The whole thing is bolted to the wall behind it, and there is a boatload of weight inside, just storage on this bench. So, you know, it's... You know, that bench ain't moving, and I'm, you know, hauling on it pretty hard, okay? So, stability is everything in hand sanding. So, get the sturdiest base that you can possibly get when you go to set up your hand sanding station. Now, for the actual hand sanding station, all I've got here is I've got a piece of 1-inch steel channel, and it is C-clamped to the bench. Then I have a 1x1 probably piece of poplar, and it is clamped on top of that. You can kind of see it's clamped right there. Okay, so that when I grab a hold of this thing, I mean, it does have a little bit of movement, but not a whole lot. So we've got the steady figured out. Now the next thing is your working height. Okay, you need to be able... One nice thing about having a stand-up hand sanding station like this is that I can really lean into that and use my body weight, or at least the weight from my shoulders and my upper body, you know, to do an awful lot of the work rather than tire out my wrists and my forearms. The more tired you get, the more likely you are to get into a rush. Or the more likely you are to get into a rush to finish it, and then that's when you're going to cut yourself. When I cut myself, it was this thumb. And I don't know if you can see. Oh yeah, it looks like you can see the scar. Okay, it goes from... Let me get a pen to point. The cut goes from there all the way down around, up around in this area somewhere. And I was in a rush. That's when almost all accidents happen, is when you're in a rush, when you're tired, when you're fighting with your old lady, when you're you know, you're rushing to get that knife done for that customer who needs it in time for Christmas. That's when your accidents happen. And this one was no different. It was December 13th. And I can't remember if it was 2 or 3 years ago, but it was the reason I remember it was December 13th. It was because The Hobbit was coming out. And you know, they had advertised, you know, The Hobbit, and my boy wanted to go see it and everything. And so he and I had both been waiting rather impatiently to go see this movie. And the movie was going to start in about an hour. And I wanted to get the knife I was working on finished hand sanding before we left. That way, when we got back, I could go on to the next step on it. So I was in a rush, and you'll notice that this stick right here is only an inch wide, and I was working on a 2-inch wide chef's knife, and I had it clamped up, big old C clamp, I had it clamped up like this. Now I had it moved in farther, had this clamp pulled it out, you know, but this is just a quick demonstration. So with this clamped up like this, you can see right off the bat. Now, the reason this stick right here is at a point is so that normally, like this is the blade we're going to hand sand today, you can put it right on there. It's less than an inch wide, and that point can line up with the point on this. So if I accidentally, you know, go into it, you know, that stick right there is going to protect my abdomen from the point of that knife. Okay, so I had it clamped up. And I'll show you the problem. Now, again, imagine that this tip was even with this. I had that part right. But a 2-inch wide blade on a 1-inch wide stick. See that? Now, I use these sanding sticks. This one's made out of steel. It's just a piece of 1/8 inch 440, you know, just some blade stock that I had that was the right size. And then you just wrap the paper. Take a fresh sheet of paper, cut it in half lengthways, fold it up to there, and then just wrap it real tight all the way around it. And that gives your sandpaper, you know, good backing, and round off the ends so that, you know, you have something nice and easy that's comfortable to work with. So here I am hand sanding this blade, and I'm not really sure why I did it, but now with wider blades, I generally use, you know, a much longer sanding stick, and that way, you know, I have more of a stroke. So I had just finished up a stroke, and for some reason I let my thumb drop. Then, as I went to pull my hand back, that blade caught into the underside of my thumb, and my arm was already in motion. So as the edge was cutting into my thumb, of course I'm driving it back. Then all of a sudden I felt it start cutting. So what do? I jerk it back even harder, and it cut straight down to either the bone or the ligaments. I mean, when I opened it up, there was something white inside of it. But, you know, I flexed my thumb. It was still working. The movie was starting in 30 minutes. So my wife told me, "Hey, let's go to the emergency room." And I said, "Are you kidding? The movie starts in a half an hour." So I taped it up, put some popsicle sticks, you know, on either side of it so I couldn't flex my thumb anymore. And the way, popped a couple of ibuprofen, and away the movie was we went. But anyway, that was a long story. This is the most dangerous thing in the shop, as far as I'm concerned. Probably even more dangerous than a buffing wheel, because I don't use a buffing wheel. So now, of course, I have another 1-inch wide stick that will clamp up to this, you know, to make sure that the edge of that blade is at the edge of the sanding stick so that can't happen again. So anyway, so we got safety out of the way. We got the solid bench. We've got the attachment so that we have something to attach it to. Let's go over sandpaper. I keep all my sandpaper. Let's put it over here. All my loose sandpaper in this stackable filing something or other. It's got a nice lid. You can come up in there and see, you know, I've got marked, that's 400 grit paper. That's 150 grit paper. I buy most of my hand sanding paper from Home Depot. Anything down to about 400 grit you can get from Home Depot. This is the stuff they've been carrying lately. Let's grab a new sheet because it'll have the whole thing. This is made by 3M. It's 220 grit fine, made in Canada. No slip grip backing. It doesn't say what kind of abrasive is in it, but it works really well. Let's put that back in the. It lasts a good long time. It's a nice color so that you can see when it's all clogged up. Got the same stuff in 120 grit, Norton 3X. Anything below about 400 to 600 grit, you're probably gonna have to run to the automotive store, like AutoZone or O'Reilly's, something like that. Here's some Gator Power stuff, which I got this at Lowe's, and I don't particularly care for it, but when you go to the parts store, you can get like this stuff, Imperial Wetter Dry 800 grit. They'll go all the way down to, well, there's some 3000, 1500s, all that kind of stuff. Generally speaking, I go, my favorite finish is a hand sanded and then etched in ferric chloride. And I only hand sand them down to about 600 grit. So let's take one of these slightly modified Carter pattern Neckers. 16th inch stock, probably about a 3/4 to a inch wide blade. This one right here, I decided to leave the finger choil out. Just see how I kind of like that. Anyway, so you can see this part right here has still got heat treating scale, and the bevels have been finished down to a, I don't know, maybe a 220 grit, maybe a 120, something like that. Generally speaking, I will take a blade and clamp it edge up or spine up in the vise over there, and go ahead and clean up the spine before I do the flats. But we'll go ahead and do the flats right now anyway, because, well, the bench part or the bench, cleaning up the spine doesn't take very much time at all. So anyway, I'm gonna go ahead. Let's get you over here a little bit closer. Get you angled down so you can see. And we might have too much light. There we go. Okay. So we're gonna use the C clamp and clamp this down. This clamp, not only does it hold the blade in position, but it also tightens up the 1 inch piece of wood to the 1 inch piece of square tubing. So you can tell it's a pretty solid setup. Now let's see, how am I gonna just move you around about like this? I think that'll work out pretty good. Let's see, how's the light? That's way too much light. Okay, so we'll just have to do it this way. I'll start off with 220 grit paper, and you just tear off the used piece. Okay, so we'll come in usually with the 220 grit. I like to start up here in the ricasso area and just clean up this plunge line. So I'm gonna want to get that edge right up inside there to get rid of any unevenness from this side to the other side, and just clean it up real nice. Okay, then usually my grind lines off the grinder are going this way. Okay, so if I come in this way, I won't be able to see when I've got all those grind lines out. So I want to come in at an angle about like this. And I don't know if you can see it through the camera, but it goes really fast. And by alternating your the angle of attack for your sandpaper to the blade, the previous grit scratches show up really, really nice. Let's see if we can't. Well, I can't see it in the camera. You might be able to see it a little bit better on the screen. There we go. Okay. Now you can see how this part's all nice and cleaned up. And then, because our scratch pattern is going this way. And you can see right in there, there's still some of the scratches from the belt grinder going that away. So we'll go back in and clean those up. Probably the best hand sanding video I've ever seen on YouTube is by Nick Wheeler. Nick Wheeler does, I mean, I've never met him, and he doesn't know I'm saying this, but just from, you know, where I've seen him on the internet, the guy does some fantastic finish work. And he does really good YouTube videos also. In fact, he stutters and stammers an awful lot less than I do, so probably makes them better. He likes to do the same sort of setup. Only it looks to me like he likes to sit down while he's hand sanding. Whereas I like to stand up. And I'm really not all that fond of the super, super detailed and clean finishes. I like mostly, you know, using and work knives. Okay, so this blade right here has got all the ones that I can see in this light anyways of the machine finishes. The scratches were going this way. We came in this way with 220 grit, and I can't see any more of the machine finishes or machine scratches. So now we'll go to 400 grit paper. And on 400 grit paper, I like to come back in and get rid of the 220 grit scratches in the plunge line. And I like to go across them like this just because it's a little bit easier. The paper cuts it more aggressively going this way than it will going this way. Because this way it'll be trying to come up that plunge, up that groove. It'll be trying to come up this, and it won't have as much time to cut going that way as it does coming in from the side like this. Okay, so once that's been cleaned up, then I like to come in and go lengthways. Now, right off the bat, within the first, you know, 10, 20 strokes or so, you can really see it's doing the same thing. Like right here, I see I got a couple of scratches here, a couple here in the belly, and a whole bunch right up in here. And that part of the paper, the finer grit paper, it seems like loads up faster. So we just tear that paper off, switch to the other side. Now, doing this, you'll get a whole bunch of stop and starts. They call them J-hooks, because they look like little half circles when you get down there and really look at them. But at this point, we're not really too worried about that. We're just trying to get all of the diagonal 220 grit scratches gone. And you can also, if you don't want to wrap the paper around the block like I do, you know, wrapping the paper around the block, the more wraps you have, the softer that corner is on your sanding stick. So if you're doing something where you're trying to maintain really, really crisp grind lines, it might be best to take your your half sheet of paper, and instead of wrapping it all the way around, this is 400 grit, yeah, it might be best to do it like this, so that you only have that one wrap. And then to move on to another section, you just bring it down and then grab it again. You can do that also. Me personally, this finish is going to get etched in ferric chloride anyway. Maybe we'll have a second to do that. No, we're not going to. We're at 4 minutes already. Or 4 minutes left. So anyway, so once you have, you know, all of the, Nick calls it a dirty 400 grit finish, you'll still, you know, every scratch that's on this blade is a 400 grit scratch. But you have all your stops and starts and your J-hooks and everything. So then what you do is you come back in and without stopping, you come back in using a fresher piece of paper every time, or a fresher section of that paper every time, and clean all of those stop and starts out. Anyway, you keep doing that until all your stop and starts are out of the way, and you can get a nice smooth 400 grit finish. Now you can take this finish as, you know, as far as you want to. I mean, if you want to spend the time, you can take it down to, I think it said 3000 grit paper, and then switch to, you know, polishing compounds and everything. Like I said, I usually like 400 to a 600 grit hand sanded finish, either clean or then etched in ferric. And you know, that's just because that's the kind of finish that I like, I guess. Anyway, that's hand sanding a blade when you get finished with this side. Pop the C-clamp off. Wipe your stick down to make sure that you don't have any particles of grit that are up underneath there that are going to mar this side of the finish. Put it back on that side. Clamp it back down. And go to town on that side. If you're going really fine finishes, it's usually best to do like two grits in a sequence. So do like 220 and 400 on this side, swap it over, wipe the stick off, do 220 and 400 on that side, then go to 600 and 800 on this side, pull the blade off, wipe the stick off, go back to the other side and do 600 and 800 on that side, you know, and so on and so forth, so that if you have a piece of coarser grit that gets stuck up underneath here, you know, you're only out one grit on your paper. This same sort of setup also works great for hand sanding handles. You'll just have to do, like, here's a junk knife. If you're going to do the handles, you would grab one of your sanding sticks, stick it up underneath the blade, put a piece of leather on top of it, clamp it down, and then you can hand sand your handle. It's a really, really nice fixture. I've sanded a whole bunch of blades on it. Anyway, that's hand sanding, is according to me, I guess. Hope you enjoyed the video, and we'll see you next time.